So I would like, thank you for that. Okay. My name is Dana Wor. Sorry, I'm unable to share my camera right now. And welcome so much for this session. So without wasting any much time, I would like to invite Estelle. Will give us a Dr. Estelle will give us a brief introduction, then probably we can start with the session. Welcome, Dr. Estelle.
Thank you, Dinah. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can hear me. Dinah, the system says I cannot put my video. Not sure why. It's not enabled.
Sorry?
It shows me that the system cannot enable me to put my video. You cannot start your video because your
Okay.
topic
Okay.
says.
Let us see what you can do. Just try now. I don't know why it hasn't.
I have a same message.
This time.
I have the same message. I think let me start, and as we go, perhaps you can see me as we go. Sure.
Okay, we are
Can you see
able
me?
to see your
Okay, is it on slide
screen.
still?
Yes.
Oh, okay, perfect. Yeah. So good afternoon, everyone, again, and yeah, and thank you for having me for these. I think yeah, it's coming on now. Yeah, perfect. Thank you for having me on this webinar. My name is Estelle Monique Sidze. I'm a senior researcher with the African Population and Health Research Center. And at the center, I lead work on maternal and adolescent mental health. So, leading a team of researchers developing proposals and engaging, funders, engaging communities, and also engaging all sorts of stakeholders on mental health issues for adolescents and for mothers. So, it's a pleasure for me to be here and a pleasure for me to provide some guidance. To help all the potential applicants to be able to develop compelling proposals for this call that we have put out. And then hopefully we can have excellent work that is implemented to solve some of those mental health issues within our population on the continent. So I want to take about 30 minutes maximum to give you some tips on how to prepare compelling applications and also what you need to think of when you're developing this application and yeah and how to prepare in generally yeah and then we can take time and I hope at least 20 minutes for you to ask questions or clarifications or further understanding of some issues I've talked about and then yeah so let's make it as interactive as possible. So I will put my video down now and then start the presentation. Yeah, so as I say, these are really basics of grant writing. And this presentation has been made through another project that we're currently running with support from amazing funders to enhance or to capacity strengthen African researchers to write compelling grants. So we're borrowing some of those slides, and we're happy that they allow us to also use it for this particular project. So the slides gives you it's basically two things. So if you look at my outline, so the first thing is really what makes a strong application, and then the second thing is what are some of those assessment criteria that are used to judge a strong application, or at least for you to win the grant, and we call it the four P's. I will take you through what we call the four P's. So I want to focus mostly on these two here. But again, if you have questions or further clarifications, I can give you more insight. But I thought of really focusing on this for this particular presentation. Yeah. So let me start by what makes a strong application. As you all know, when we have a call out like this one, there are many people who are applying. You're not the only one who is applying. So meaning that the team that is receiving the proposal is receiving a number of applications. And if you look at some of the calls, not just this one, generally, for you to keep in mind, sometimes you can receive up to 2,000, 5,000, 7,000 applications across different, institutions, and all of those institutions are strong institutions or across different individual strong researchers also. But the funding is not unlimited, meaning that there need to be a selection process, and to go through the selection process and make sure that you are the person who is selected for receiving the grant, there's some criteria that needs to, to stand out, or these things that need to stand out from your application. And for this particular call on mental health, what we want to see in your application is really the proposed innovation, the impact of your proposed innovation. We want to see how your proposal is articulated, so it has to be well articulated. We want to see how innovative and unique your approach is. And we also want to assess the capacity of your team to deliver on what is proposed. So very, very critical criteria that you now start to think about when you're developing your application. So as I say, the proposed innovation, how it's articulated, the innovation and uniqueness of the approach, and also the capability of your team to deliver on this. So these four criteria are very important. So again, as I say, there are many applications that will come through, but what makes your application stand out is really these four criteria. So now, if you look at now, if you go in depth in terms of what I call it, the three or the four P criteria for assessing a proposal in general, and of course for this particular call, we normally focus on three different things. The first thing is the person, meaning the person applying, and in most cases we call it the primary applicant or the PI, the principal investigator. Sometimes you hear PI. So the person, but also the team. I will show you that also the team is important. The second thing, the place environment, meaning that the institution in which the proposal or the project will be, led, the project will be led from or will be implemented. And then the third one is the project itself. And I'll go through these different P's and give you more detail. But if you remember, I say four P's because these are the main three P. But the four P's that we're constantly adding now when we're doing this kind of exchange or training is that we're really focusing on a four P, that is planning, because we realize a lot of our researchers or researchers in general, but also researchers working in NGOs, universities, and anyone anyway applying for these particular calls, we always realize that things are done in a rush at the end. So we're also trying to now stress a lot on how to plan. So that's why I say there's a 4P, which is planning, and I will get to that later. But let's start with the first one, the person. As I say, the person is very important. I know when you're preparing your applications, you'll have to determine or to identify who is the lead for this particular submission. Yeah. So who is as I say, the primary applicant, and who is the principal investigator? So to be able to determine that, there's some criteria, because when you assess also a submission, we're looking also at the different characteristics or different strength that principal investigator have. And some of those are listed here. So we want to see that the person leading this particular concept or proposal has a strong track record appropriate to his career stage. A strong track record. Strong track record meaning that the person has worked in that particular field and in the positions where through his publication, through his research, through his engagement with communities, through different perhaps past grants or projects that he has, is at a stage where he can actually effectively lead this particular submission. So it's very important that you look at that when you're proposing the lead applicant. And then you also have to look at does a person has can demonstrate potential balanced by achievements. Can we also see in terms of the person's publications what really is knowledge or his contribution to the general knowledge is all about. And then also one thing that is some funders will look at, I would say it's not something that we particularly looked at in this particular call, but sometimes it's really also important to showcase how this particular call, or what that particular, not call, but that how this particular project or proposal that you have will fit within your career development. So for example, if you're a junior career researcher now, if you're a middle career or, you know, experienced career, or if, as I say, because I know this call will not just be answered by researchers, if you work in a community-based organization or civil society organizations, you also have to somehow show that this particular project fit within a record or fit within a plan, a bigger plan in terms of, you know, solving an issue or bringing solutions around mental health research or engagement with community on mental health. So really fit within a whole, a bigger plan or bigger vision. So it's not something that is just disjointed and just, you know, come out of nowhere. So that connections to what you're doing right now is also very important sometimes to highlight and to showcase within your application. Now, the second thing, what we're looking at in terms of the lead applicant is also enough details for us to judge that the person has the requisite required qualification. That means looking at if the person can do what is proposed, meaning looking at the technical skills of the person, the expertise of the person. Also, as I said, looking at also the data on what the person has published before, the peer review paper, non-peer review paper also. It doesn't have to be peer review paper only, policy briefs that the person have developed, research briefs, you know, also general output, even the ones that people, you know, general commentaries on online and all that. Really seeing that the person has what it takes, but the person is also somebody who is like really somebody who has been working in the mental health field and bringing solutions to particular issues. And then also, as I said, show impact of your research to date. So please make sure from the lead applicant that you're selecting for your application, make sure that it's somebody, as I said, has the expertise, has done the work, the type of work before, can show that this work fits within a general vision or general, you know, body of work that is conducting, but also it's somebody who has made significant impact in that field. So please think of it when you're developing your application and thinking of your lead applicant. So now let's stop with the person or the applicant. So now the second P is the environment, the place. The place, as I said, where the person is embedded, in terms of the lead applicant is embedded to the institution is very important. But as you know, looking at the call for this particular mental health prize call, we also ask you to have research teams. The team, the members of research team can be from different institutions. So the different institutions that are listed here, we need to understand what are those institutions, how strong they are, what have they done in that particular field, the mental health field, what have they done related to what you're proposing, how does it fit within, again, a bigger vision for that particular, those particular institutions. So as much as possible, let that information be seen in your application, yeah? So now, in terms of the place or the environment, what we're looking at, the main criteria is really the quality and suitability of the environment. Yeah, so for the proposed research, we want to understand those environment or those places or institutions, do they have access to the required specialist equipment, expertise, labs, methodology, collaborators, networks? Can we see it there? And also, is there a place, if we have a lead applicant, for example, or researcher, or people propose, as I say, it doesn't have to be just researchers for this particular call, but are the people who are submitting proposals, are they in an environment where they can be supported to deliver effectively on this? So it has to be clear also. So if, for example, if let's say Estelle is within a PHRC, does Estelle has a mentor? Does Estelle have somebody who support her? Does Estelle has access to a monitoring team? Does Estelle has access to data analysts who can support her? to be able to deliver on the proposal. Those are the kind of thing that we also want to understand from the environment that is proposed. So really, as I said, is your institution the right one to host this application? This is what we are looking at. So at least from my perspective, but we can have insight from the rest of the team. I will assume that all institutions that you all embedded in have the right environment and can support you. But as I say again, it's up to you to really also highlight that in the, either in the capacity, the statement of the organization, but also in terms of the opportunities that you have within your institutions to deliver on the work. You have to really be clear to highlight that also in your proposal. Now, this is environment. And as I said, we expect that you're not proposing this as a single individual, that this will be research teams, ideally. When we talk, if you see the call details, we say we want to see in your team different criteria or characteristics that is really important for us. So the compositions, the roles of the different member, the description of the team diversity, including the skill and gender balance. Gender balance is very important. So the team composition, as we mentioned, the name, the affiliations, the country, the qualification, the specialty. And for this, we want to see who the lead applicant is, the institutions, the expertise, and the skills, and also the co-lead applicant. We also want to see which institutions and which expertise they have. And again, as I say, the place, environment, what are some of those strengths of the institution that where they're embedded. And then descriptions of the team diversity is something that is required within the proposal body. We said maximum 350 word. So we say please align how your proposed team brings together skilled individual organizations, how you promote diversity and inclusion in terms of skills and background. While relevant, take steps to include representative, experienced expert, lived experience expert, and also policymakers in your team. But my team and Mulse would go more maybe in depth if you have questions around those. But what it means really is that if I can give you a tip in that way, most of the time we list individuals or we list institutions because we want, for example, the list or the research team to look fancy, but we fail to actually explain in our proposal how is this the best team to deliver on this. So really understand that you have to be able to put up a team that has the expertise, the right expertise, but also if you have a team and multiple individuals, you also have to show why the expertise is important, how the expertise of the different people is complementary. So you don't just have to list people because of this, just for the sake of it, but they have to have complementary skills. So if let's you say that you want to look at anxiety, for example, as an outcome, and look at innovations around, biological factors or social determinant factors, you need to have, of course, in your team somebody who is strong in terms of biological analysis. You have somebody who is strong in terms of analysis, social determinants analysis. So you just don't list people, really. That's the tip. Don't just list people, but make sure that each person that is listed is in the right environment to deliver on the job, but also has the expertise and has expertise that fit within what you're proposing. So that's what I want to highlight here. Now let's go to the third P. The third P is, of course, a research proposal. The main thing that we're looking at is what you're proposing. And what we're looking for is really the quality of that proposal, the quality of the research question in particular. So here we want to look at how the idea is important, how will it make a significant difference to the field, how you have strong research hypothesis that underpins your proposal. You have a clear outline of your aims and objectives that can be supported by appropriate study design to tackle your aims and objective, measurement tools, clear outcomes, robust analytical approaches, and of course, ethical aspect. If you deal with human subject, that you have to also clarify what are some of those ethical considerations that you are taking. And we know the mental health is a field, in the mental health field, that addressing or at least talking speaking or discussing, addressing around mental health in within at least within our region, comes with a lot of stigma, meaning that it's we assume that if you involve individuals to talk about mental health, there need to be a lot of safeguarding and a lot of ethical considerations that you need to put in place. So that has to be very clear in your proposal. But if you look at the image that I put on the left, you can see in terms of project that they're hitting six key things, steps you have to plan. So basically, as you start now thinking of applying, you can now start, you know, just drafting, like take a book note and start, what is my topic? What am I proposing? So plan, you have to analyze, you have to research, you have to have a solution, develop, execute. So try and put notes down. Now, what is my research question, or what is my aim, literally? What is my aim? What are my objectives? What is the innovations around this particular problem that I want to tackle? How will I analyze it? How will I go about it? How will I approach people? How will I collect data? Or if there's no data collection, how will I get the information without collecting data? How will I make the analysis? What are some of those novel, you know, methodologies that I will propose? And how will I implement that? How will I, do I use softwares? If yes, which softwares? So literally, how do I execute this? So my advice and tip all the time on this is, before you start writing, like really writing, take time to sit with your team that you have identified, because again, as I said, expertise and the strength, you sit together and you start what we call brainstorming session. We always start proposal development by a brainstorming session. So we don't start writing straightforward. We sit together with that team that you have identified, and as I say, put down what is your the problem, and what are you proposing? What is innovative about that? And you can start, you know, exchanging ideas, putting things on the whiteboard. As you say, sometimes you can brainstorm with a whiteboard, and then at the end of that session, it can be 1, 2, 3, 4 sessions. When you decide on what you want to work on, you can now go ahead and start drafting. So it's really important that you plan, that you analyze, that you identify your solution and how you will execute it before you even start writing your application. Now, if I move to the next slide, so you know the goal of this Mental Health Data Prize Africa, and the goal is to produce tangible and scalable digital outputs or solutions that support mental health research and or generate data-driven insight evidence tailored to the needs and priorities of the African population while building data capacities on the continent. So keep in mind the big, bold, you know, things that have been put in bold on color there, tangible and scalable digital outputs and solutions. We want solution-oriented proposals. My colleague Mercy and the rest will take you through again of the remit of this particular call. But please keep in mind what we're looking is solutions-oriented proposals. So again, coming back to my previous slide, before you start drafting something, rushing to start developing something, really sit with your team and start thinking, what are these solutions that I'm bringing? Is this scalable digital output that I want to come with to solve this mental health issue? What is even the mental health issue that I want to solve? Is it depression? Is it anxiety? Is it psychosis? Is it something else? So start thinking of this, as I say, very carefully. And when you develop or when you brainstorm, this first session of brainstorming that I talked about, really make sure that you always have the goal of a call in mind. Yeah, always. As I said, you can have within your institutions or you as a researcher, bigger goal or bigger vision or where you want in terms of mental health research or action. But start thinking about this call in particular. What is the remit? What are they looking for? So that when you start developing something or brainstorming with your team, you actually brainstorm on something that falls within the remit of this call. Because sometimes one pitfall that that applicants do is to submit something that is very interesting, well articulated, but does not fall within the remit of a call. And you'll be surprised that you receive an email say, oh, unfortunately, we cannot consider your application. And you'll be like, oh, but I spent 1, 2 months with my team. We put our best foot forward. We developed something brilliant. We have a brilliant institution that can deliver this. We have the expertise, the right CV, the right team and everything, but they still say no. It's just because, you know, the research is good, it's nice, it's innovative, that it does not fit within the remit of this call. So take time, look at the guidance again and again and again and again, and make sure that you develop something that fits within the call. This is something that we ask you within the guidance for how you develop your document. One thing that I wanted to highlight here is that this is normally the major and the most important section of your application, the background. And most of the time, the background we have 1,500 or 2,500 words, depending on funders. For this particular call, we tell you 1,500 words. And when you say 1,500 words, we mean 1,500 words. Yeah, so you have to remain, keep in mind, also as a tip when you develop proposals, when you look at guidance on what needs to fit in a particular section, make sure that you answer all the questions, or at least you write things that fit within all what is required for that particular section. So pay attention to it. Pay attention to it. So if you say, for example, for this background, we tell you, discuss how proposed methods, solutions, tools, advance understanding for anxiety, depression, or psychosis, or the mental health problems that you're choosing. We want you to detail how the proposed tool, if applicable, or method has the potential to provide a novel way of addressing data or research needs. We want you to discuss how project will significantly contribute to understanding of mental health, body of knowledge, etc. So when we say these three things in this particular section, it means when a reviewer will assess your proposal, they actually want to see these three things, you know, described properly within your proposal. So that's why I'm taking time to really stress this. This is just for the background, but a different section in your proposal. But those different sections, just make sure that as a tip, very important tip to have a winning proposal, make sure that you read the guidance. Read the guidance, respond, or at least write things that fit within what is expected in this, and stick to the number of words that is being asked from you. So let me move to the next one. So the second thing that is really important also for research when you're proposing is what we call the feasibility. Again, as I say, you might have a very beautiful proposal, beautiful research questions, aims, objective, sampling, everything is written properly, but is it feasible? Is also a question that a reviewer or reviewers can ask themselves. Is it feasible? And feasible, not because the person doesn't have expertise. We already said at the beginning, you need to have the right expertise, the right institution to implement. But is it feasible in itself? Meaning that you have available resources. So you want to perhaps do something that is overambitious. You have a limited budget. So we can tell you this is not, you know, this is overambitious. It cannot be delivered within the timelines, the 1 year that is required, or the budget that is required. And maybe that's why you receive a no. So pay attention to that. So really look at the available resources and what you're proposing. Are they speaking to each other? So the funding period, as I said, if it's 1 year or 2 year, make sure that you propose activities that fit within that funding period, so that you, and in a very reasonable way. So as you see, for example, for application, we'll say, I will take 1 month to do my analysis, for example. And we know that 1 month, if you look at a proposal and you look at the different types of analysis and the layers of complexity of the modeling, we know it cannot take 1 month because you only have one or two data analysts also in the team. So we know as reviewers that this will not be possible. So pay attention to what activities you are proposing, what can reasonably being a level of effort and time required for those activities, and can all those activities fill within the funding period and within the funding level in terms of amount of money that you have before you submit. You have to look at, do you have preliminary data? So as I said, we assume that you're all mental health practitioners or researchers in the continent or working on the continent, and that you have been working on this before. So that means that perhaps you want to propose something that extends from a previous work that you're currently doing, because you saw some gaps and you want to perhaps go in depth in a particular, with a particular research question. If it fits within a broader study that you have, say it, that it fits within a broader study, but for this particular study or with this particular project, I want to do this and analyze this for so and so reason, and how it tie back to the main, your main project. And then if there are preliminary data that you have already that can make people realize, or reviewers being confident that there's something that can actually be delivered within the time frame, also bring that out. And then the risk and contingency, we always say for applications, always talked about risk and contingency. The world is not, so will not work the way we want. We can have, you know, amazing plans and all that, but for some reason, those plans get derailed because, you know, a document was not received on time, fieldwork is not going the way we want, somebody in the team has an issue. There's a lot of things that can go wrong, really, within that 1 year, even with the best, you know, planning possible. So make sure that you talk about the risk and contingency. What do you see as risk and contingency for this, for your project, and how those will be tackled when they come out? And then I said already the appropriateness of the resources requested. The budget has to fit within the activity. But also you have to make sure that if you have, as I say, sometimes when you have research teams, we tend to list a number of people. And now when we start building the budget, that's when realizing, oops, we cannot pay everyone within that budget. And then we go backward and realize, actually, do we need all of those people? So again, if you remember what I said at the beginning, take time to actually select your team, and the skills have to be appropriate, adapted to your proposal, and complement. And you have to make sure before you even start brainstorming and engaging people that you have, I know, resources to be able to fit all of those different members of your team within your budget. So yeah, so those are all of those things, the tips that I can give you around feasibility. And then my last slide around the proposal itself is really think through your idea and be realistic. Think through your idea. As I said, take time to brainstorm. Don't rush, don't start writing, brainstorm, and really understand what you want to bring that is new, novel, and if you have the capacity to do that. But think through also in terms of, do you have an hypothesis that is interesting and that can actually be tested within this particular project? You know, one thing that we put there in quotes, one thing that we've seen in application, people say, oh, this is completely novel. I will do things that have never been done before. But when you go on Google, you just type, you have like 10,000, you know, output regarding that same question that the person want to be answer, want to answer in the proposal. So make sure that you don't use words like novel approaches on things if you know that's not true. So make sure that you propose things that you know are things that are novel, but also things that perhaps we need more information about, or we need new information about, but some things that have been researched again and researched again, and really, we don't want to spend again more resources trying to research the same thing. But as we said, we can people can have questions that have been answered or novel innovations that have been, you know, implemented in other contexts. If you want to do that, then you have to explain that this has been done before in this context, but we want to contextualize, make it culturally appropriate for this particular, you know, context, and this is the reason why we think it can work in a particular context, but it cannot work because it has not been contextualized. So again, really think through your idea and ask yourself, is this something that yourself even will put money on? So that meaning that you have to think about an idea that really you are sure that somebody will want to put money on something that is new, but novel, but also something, not even it's not novel, something that actually brings something new to the body of evidence, or at least bring a new solution to the table in a particular context. And then again, as I said, be realistic, be realistic. Most of the time, the pitfall is that we are overambitious. Yes, we work in the field of mental health. There's so many ideas that we have already, but there's so many other calls and funders. So for this particular call, be realistic, get a specific goal and aim and research question or activities, and make sure that, as I say, they fit within your timeline, fit within your budget, they're achievable, you have the required expertise, and then you can deliver that on that. And then you can, of course, look for different streams of funding to continue the different, you know, researching on the different questions that you have. So please keep in mind, be realistic. All your nice ideas, if cannot fit within these calls, don't get frustrated. There are so many other calls, but make sure that for this particular one, you give us something that fit within the call remit, but also that is achievable within the time and budget. And then the last thing, be clear, tell a story, be clear. So when you read through, make sure that it's clear, people will understand, they will see where you want to go. We also say have a backup plan. Backup plan in the sense that, as I told you, things sometimes do not go according to plan. But if you have risk and contingencies that you really highlight on your proposals, this is good. But also for you in your mind, also when you're brainstorming with your team, start thinking of a backup plan. So you see, for example, during COVID struck at some point, there were so many projects on the ground, people had to readjust. So having a backup plan actually helped a lot of people to move along past COVID. So for any project that you're proposing, have that backup plan. Say, for example, I have 1 year, I need to deliver this, but put in your note somewhere at the back of your mind, of your team, on your whiteboard, that if this does not work, what can we do? What are some of those alternatives? If you cannot get data from this person, if you cannot get this MOH person the way, you know, they're okay with working with us, but in case they say no at the last minute, who else can we reach out to? So start having a backup plan and put it somewhere so that you don't delay it. You really deliver on time, because, you know, most funders, and including for this particular call, do not want to have no cost extension or go beyond the period of the project grant. So make sure that you have backup plan. And then, of course, the proofread and spell check. We don't want applications that are not been formatted, that the flow is daunting. So make sure that, you know, proofread and spell check is done properly. Now, I talked to you about the fourth P, yeah, preparation, that we add now to the main three P's, because we think it's very important. The first thing, know your audience. Give yourself enough time. Don't do last minute rush. Don't do last minute rush. So take your time, draft, as I say, brainstorm, draft your proposal, and you can draft it on the Word format actually before you copy paste in the online platform. So don't go and type on the online platform last minute, like 2 days before the submission, with a lot of, you know, mistakes and a lot of flow and issues, and you expect to actually receive a positive answer. So make sure that you plan accordingly before you submit, and that you have enough time to submit. Again, as I check remit and eligibility, we already said provide all the information that is required. If they say your CV, letter of support, letters of your institutions and all that, make sure that you have them. Make sure that they're uploaded. Yeah. And then you follow the instruction closely. I told you, if the sections have instructions, a number of words, make sure that you follow them. And check again, and check by others. And this ties with do your work on time, so that you have time for people to read for you. Make sure that you do that, because it's very important. You can develop something and you think, oh, I have everything nailed down. And sometimes you say, don't even give to people who are expert in the field, give in a general audience, general lay person to read. Actually, is my proposal make sense? Is my solution make sense? Does my solution make sense? Or does my proposal make sense? And somebody can tell you, but you forgot this step. Some, you know, small things that maybe you didn't pick yourself. So my advice to you will be, make sure that you develop your proposal at least 2 to 3 days before the submission time deadline, and make it read by an expert in the field, by your colleagues, by supervisors in your institution that you, if you have, by other researchers, if you're a researcher and you propose something that is research oriented, make sure that people read. But for CSO NGOs, make sure that even people that you work in the field, that, you know, you can give this to read quickly. Somebody from the ministry that you want to include in your team, make sure they read, and they can let you know if there are gaps that you perhaps have within your write-up, and you can quickly work on fixing those before you submit. So, yeah. And of course, as I say, check the submission format, the required appendices. I will go back to there also. So I hope you have all the tips from this presentation, and I will stop here. If you have questions, as I say, clarifications and further questions on the some particular aspects of this proposal, I will be happy to answer to those. Thank you for your attention. Dinah, am I speaking to
Thank you.
myself or are
Thank
you
you.
there?
No,
Okay,
you're
thanks.
fine.
Okay.
Thank you very much. That was quite a very good session. Maybe we can take some questions. Can we have some raised hands and I can allow you to speak? Okay, here we go. Let's start with the rain. Pijoti, go ahead. Erin, you can unmute and speak.
Well, thank you very much for the nice presentation, Estelle, and thank you for this opportunity to ask a question. I saw that the proposals must focus either on the two roles, on the two areas. First, developing a digital solution, or the second, bringing up a data insight. So assuming like I want to develop a proposal based on the something which bring an insight from data, and I don't have enough data for doing that analysis, will the program assist me with the extra data so that I'll bring up an insight which covers, I mean, all aspects of the mental health? Thank you.
You know, should I respond to immediately after?
Yeah, maybe you can answer that since we don't have another question at the moment.
Yeah, thank you, Ellen. I think that's an important question that perhaps Maurice and the team will respond to you also after my answer. But if I understand, we do not want project where people will say, let me, you know, fund me also to go and collect primary data collections to do this or do that. So what we're looking for really, as I mentioned, is well-articulated concept to answer to a particular question within a one-year period. And what I showed in terms of the goal, the overall goal of the data prize, this mention around, you know, digital solutions and all that, and digital tools is the general aim of this initiative. But what we want to see from different concepts, Mulse will go through that in terms of the different topic that you could cover in this particular call, and the things that, you know, will not be, you know, funded or will not fit within the remit of this call. So we'll give you more details about that, because mine is really in terms of, you know, giving you tips on how to put together the documents well. But in terms of detail, you know, your detailed questions from your side or people in the audience around what we can, you know, cover or not, these details will be given by my colleague later on. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I also have other question. Actually, you can use the Q&A section to also write your questions. I also have another question here. And it's from, okay, anonymous. So it says that, thank you for the great presentation. As a PhD student waiting to apply for the funding, do you also have to write with a team? I will also be noting some of these questions since they will also be addressed by Murusu, the one regarding to the project. But I think his question is about if being part of a student, a PhD student, they have to apply as part of a team.
Yeah, I can see the question and answer. Maybe answer to them as I read through. So ideally for, okay, it's anonymous attendee, so I can see your name, but as we say, ideally, a proposal needs to have a team. And a team, why? As I mentioned, because you need different expertise. different expertise, unless you can prove that I can be the person who will conceptualize this, I'm the person who is doing the analysis, I'm the person who will implement on the field, I'm the person who will be doing everything, which is not possible generally. So I will advise you to, even if you're a PhD student and you work, because you work within a team or you work with a mentor or supervisor, I think it's great for you to see what do you want to propose? Does it fit within general questions that you have within your PhD, not part of your PhDs, but part of your research, your bigger research ideas? Can you talk to it, talk a bit about it to your supervisor or your mentor or people who work within the lab or the institution or the department where you are located right now, and tell them, I've seen this call, I want to apply, I'm thinking of this, which is also linked to my PhD, but I want to explore this. Is it possible for me to work with you, meaning your supervisor or mentor, or any colleague in your institution? And then you build a team from there and start brainstorming. That's what I will perhaps I tell you. So build that team. I don't think you can apply alone as a PhD student to do this. Now, the other questions, I just want to ask about novelty. For most of us in the developing world, anything you attempt thinking it's novel, you realize that this most has been done elsewhere. Yeah, that's what I was approaching in my presentation, talking about, because we use the word novelty too often. And sometimes, as I say, somebody go quickly and type and see so many entries across around the same topic. I think it's just for you, as I say, when you're brainstorming and thinking about your innovation and novelty, ask yourself and with the member of your team, what is really novel about it? Again, brainstorm around that. What is novel? Is it the topic itself? Is it the way you approach it? Is it the methodology that you're using? Is it, I don't know, is it the fact that perhaps it has been done somewhere and it has not been done in your country or the context that you want? It has been done maybe with high income population, not done with low income population. You just have to know and to understand what is novel about it, because there's always something new. Because if you have something that is funded, as I say, you need to have value for funding. Be funding things that actually will, as I say, advance knowledge, bring us a step further in the knowledge, meaning that when you even develop that background of yours of 1,500 words, you have to understand clearly in your head, what is that new thing that I'm bringing? It doesn't have to be innovation in the sense of something, you know, out of this world, but what is this new evidence or new tool or new approaches to doing things or new, I don't know, new way of doing this contextually around mental health that I'm bringing this particular proposal. And it can only come across, that I will tell you by experience, if you brainstorm, you take your time to brainstorm with your team, you'll have you know, clear guidance around that within your team. The next question is, a number of us would like to propose a systematic review, but you have been given mixed answer about whether this will be considered. I'm not sure systematic review is a novel thing. I'm sure you agree with me. Systematic review is just to give us a synthesis of what exists in the literature. I don't think, remember, I explained, no funder wants to fund ideas that do not have value for money. So if you propose a systematic review, there is no value to fund those, because it doesn't mean any new solution or new ways of doing things around, you know, in the mental health field. So my question, my answer to you also will be, there's no value for money there. The next question is, can we submit a proposal for just conducting, I think, systematic review? I think we answered that also, Theresia, because I don't think there is value for money for systematic review. For Kimbewa Peter, are we supposed to apply to institution and organization, or are we apply as individual researchers? To Peter, as I mentioned, you need to have an institution. Again, as I say, a team, an institution is important, because you need somebody who manages a grant. You need somebody who does accounting, auditing, all those things for you. You need somebody who the hiring, dealing with the hiring and everything. So you need a structure. You need a structure to work. You work within. So you cannot, apply as an individual without an institution. Yeah. So I hope this answers your question, Peter. Emilia, so does it mean that the team makeup does not require to purely be from mental health cohort composition? I think that my colleague can answer that more, Emilia. But I will say no. They don't have to be necessarily in the cohort composition, because if you make the case that you need expertise from, you know, from a particular researchers, because, you know, you need somebody who can, you know, look at some of those analyses in your proposal, why not? You can make the case. But as again, you can ask further questions to Molise and the team about that. What are some of those things that you need to pay attention in forming that research team? Do they really have to be there in the mental health enterprise cohort composition? I think Joel, you can put it down, and then maybe Monse can also tackle that. Do all the research team members need to be in the mental health enterprise cohort? Yeah, and then the other one from the AIMS focus is on digital solution. In our current case, can we assess the burden of mental health to help guide policy as this statistic is lacking in our context? Thank you. Again, as you say, a solutions oriented. If you propose something in terms of gathering data, not gathering data, but pulling or collecting data to understand a problem towards answering or solving something, perhaps. But again, we say solution oriented, not just evidence gathering oriented. But again, Moluse can go further on that. Lera say it should be mental health area only and or other considered. Lera, this has to be mental health only. And then the last question, I would like to know if there is cap to the grant size to apply for and what is the minimum and maximum duration. This will be answered for also in the next presentation. And you can also have time to ask more clarifications about those budget considerations. I think this is the last question from my side, Joel. Yeah, this is the last question. Yeah.
Yes.
Thanks. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. If we don't have any other questions, I don't see. Okay, I see another raised hand. Kasu, go ahead. Delatio, Cassio, go ahead. Okay. If we don't have any other questions, maybe we can have a 5 minutes break, and then we can be back for the second session with Dr. Murusu. Now, here we'll discuss more, in particular, the Mental Health Digital Prize Africa. And you can now, we can now be able to address most of those questions, even including budget. Yes. Okay, let's be back by 15:05.
Of 250, a weighted average cost of capital of 12%, and a growth rate of 3%.
Hey, thank you, everyone. We were on a break. I believe we can start. So we'll go ahead and talk about the application process for the mental health, and which will be done by Dr. Mursu Jebeda. Over to you, Dr. Mursu.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me, Joel? Can you confirm?
Yes, can hear you.
Yeah. Oh, so thank you very much. Thank you. I hope you have also enjoyed the previous presentation by Dr. Estia. Now I would like to walk you through the proposal structure. I hope you know that we have shared this proposal submission instruction sometimes back, like a month ago. Now I would like to just walk you and through that structure and what that our submission online platform would look like, what kind of content we are looking for. So before I go to the proposal structure, I want to remind you this thing. Like, you know, like 6 months ago, when we started this announce the African Mental Health Data Prize, we clearly put during our orientation and also during the capacity building program process. I hope most of you have been with us all through these 5 months. So we said, the goal of this Mental Health Data Prize is to produce tangible and scalable digital solutions that can support mental health research across Africa and or that can generate data-driven evidence or insights tailored to the need of African population. While the prize, the project also is supporting you through capacity building program, I hope. We have been through many courses up to date. So, you know, if you read our mental health data guideline, we have clearly indicated about the rationale for this prize, the rationale for this project. We explained why we need multidisciplinary approach. And the multidisciplinary is really a key word. Multidisciplinary team is a key and important keywords in that document, because we say, you know, this mental health issue is a neglected topic in Africa, and we do not understand so many things about this mental health condition in Africa. So we are calling African researchers, mainly African researchers, including you can also collaborate with the other organization or an institution across the world, but we are calling African researchers to come up, to team up and to come up together and form a multidisciplinary team. We want to really understand mental health condition from different perspective and different discipline. So your formation as a multidisciplinary approach or your approach through different perspective is really, really highly appreciated. That is one of the most important criteria. So when it comes to the proposal structure, we have 16 sections, and I will go through some of the sections, the technical part, and also explain you what we mean by when we say some of the sections. And then, like I have one small slide on budget, and where you can provide us some brief summary about your budget. So in our online platform, the first section is about project title. Suppose this is just take it as a placeholder. This is an example. Imagine you have some topic. You put in that dialog box your project title. Example, you are interested to explore advancing mental health research in Kenya, you know, some methods, X approach. Or you want to explore the age of onset of anxiety, depression, and psychosis in Africa. In this example, Next to that dialog box, there is a country, there is a question which asks you a country of focus, country where you are. It's not country of your origin, but it's country of your focus for this study. So you may mention, if you are focusing one country, you may mention, like, for example, in Kenya. Or if you are using multiple data sets from different countries, you can enter those multiple countries. It accepts those multiple names of those multiple countries. But sometimes, probably you may use some of the data sets that may cover across African region. Like you have plenty or many of African regions, and it's difficult to list all those African countries. So you can easily, the system allows you to enter the word like African continent. That means, yeah, it's telling us that this is the data set that covers across Africa. The second section is about thematic areas. We've said the proposal must address at least one of these areas, thematic area. It also must address this thematic area in relation to the three mental health conditions, anxiety, depression. We keep saying this. Our main interest is anxiety, depression, and psychosis. And the thematic area, you may either go for generating data-driven insights or develop data-driven or digital solutions that can address causal mechanism underpinning the three mental health conditions, or intervention efficacy, or explore intervention effectiveness in implementation context, or you may go to telling us about individual difference, like why some intervention work for the others, for whom, and what works kind of question. The third section is about your team. Here, it asks you about to fill two things. Don't forget about team composition. There is a table which populates name, your affiliation or organization, country of the applicant, your qualification, and then it asks you to fill either you are a lead applicant. We said, remember, if you refer our mental health data price guideline, we said the lead applicant should be based in African institutions. We don't accept any lead applicant from outside Africa. Make sure that your institutions are African, and also the lead applicants should be from Africa. The co-lead can be from anywhere else. Then there is a section, you can also feel about your colleagues or co-applicants. In this section, we need also your special CVs of key personnel that you might think would add values to your project or your proposal. And then within like less than 350, maximum of 350 words, you tell us about how you team up, how you come together, how you form this multidisciplinary team, how in that context, how did you promote diversity in terms of skill, in terms of background, in terms of expertise, especially when we say multidisciplinary team. Again, please refer our guideline. It refers about inclusion of lived experience, expert, and the policymakers in your team. That is very critical for us. And then I kindly request you to read those mental health data guidelines. The fourth section requires you to fill about the summary of your objective of your project and the key deliverables, the outcome, and the potential scalability and its anticipated outcome and benefits of that proposal or that project you are really envisioning. Probably you may summarize it as a paragraph. We don't have a specific structure, but you may like put it like structurally, start from background, the way we write like abstract in some of the journals, like you start from background, objective, methodology, anticipated deliverable, and potential scalability, if it's applicable, like if it fits to your project idea. And then, Our project is especially if you win, it should be you will be with us for 12 months. So it is, and the project duration should be 12 months. So we appreciate, good planning that your project or proposal really would be completed within 12 months. And then the most important section is also background. As Dr. Estelle said, please make sure that you have clearly stated the problem statement, what kind of problem you are really defining, and then what is the added value of your project. What is, as if you remember that slide, she discussed about the way you structurally narrate your problem statement and give us some of the added value of the research, like the significance of the study or the project. And then the second most important section is this one. We need the detailed description of design and the methodology with maximum of 150 words. And then the systems, the online platform have some like a box where you will feel about the study setting and the design relevant to your research question. You may also explain some of the conceptual or theoretical framework. Not necessarily, some of the question may not fit to this concept, but if it is applicable, please try to give us some theoretical or framework or conceptual framework that really guide your research question and hypothesis. And also tell us about how each specific objective will be achieved. And then within this project design methodology, there is a section which asks you about data and sampling. This is the most important section. When we say data and sampling, please indicate which data source you will use to either generate the evidence or to develop those thoughts, or maybe both. And the rationale for selecting this data, and also clearly describe about the target population, like give us a study description or cohort description, on which specific age group are you focusing and blah, blah. And then you explain about, if it is applicable, about sample size, sampling technique, selection criteria. Maybe, since you are using existing data source from somewhere, either from your own or from some organization, you can get some of this information from that document and then explain about the size of the sample, the sampling procedure, and the selection criteria. And then give us about the data collection methods, how it was collected. Note that this initiative is about using existing data source. We highly discourage primary data collection, and it is beyond the scope of this project. And then we have data management. In this section, you clearly describe the details of the data analysis methods, or sometimes you can say identification strategy to be used. Where it is relevant, you can also explain how you are harmonizing some of the variables. For some of the proposals, maybe suggesting AI or machine learning approach, your proposal should highlight if the work will be applying existing methods or adopting new technology or innovations. Then we have expected outcome and output. In this section, we expect you to describe the project output and the outcome, how to address existing body of knowledge, and it's of importance to policy and research or program. And the output should also point how to insight, how insight gained or the tool developed may impact people experiencing this mental health condition, especially this anxiety, depression, and psychosis. And what strategies you also undertake to ensure that your work is inclusive and aware of some of the population, especially suffering from this condition, and but also they are marginalized, and to minimize some of the harms. And then, we have to also think about the scaling impact. We expect your proposal, your idea, should focus on promising and a proven approach that has a potential to be scalable and bring some transformative change in African continent, whether now or through time. And then we encourage you to think about this, how this really our proposal is really scalable or can be scalable. When we say that it's not about increasing the size of the work, we are saying, we are asking you about the reach, the bridge, the quality, the equity, the sustainability of the change. We might benefit from this solution. And also describe how the output of the impact the lives of African population, especially of your target population, suffering from this mental health condition. And also try to outline how this scaling, how scaling approach and delivery mechanism can be also be tested. And if it is applicable, especially if you are proposing some tool, how this will enable future research, especially in related to the anxiety, depression, and psychosis. And also tell, you have to tell us how the tool can be applied within the mental health research, even beyond the scope of this data prize. Some of the tools are maybe, has universal utilities. And then there's a section which requires you to fill about project management and the collaboration. In this section, you have to provide us an overview of how the proposal, your proposed topic or project will be managed, including the role and the responsibility of your team, or maybe if you are applying as a consortium, you have to indicate the responsibility and the proposed management of the project, and also how will the approach share the ownership of the outcome among different organizations. You have to also describe about the project governance and how you are really coordinating yourself to produce high quality work. That is the most important for us. And how these relevant stakeholders, how or relevant team members, can be involved in a fair and equitable way. Especially, you have to explain how the mental health research community, people with lived experience, policymakers, can be part of this collaboration and inclusive in terms of gaining skills and background skills from this project. And also show us how this this team, this people with lived experience and policymakers and the other team member can really collaboratively work in a synergized way, so that every expertise can complement to produce that solution. Remember, if you go to the Mental Health Data Prize guideline, we said engaging lived experience expertise is mandatory. It is interesting, this project is really quite interesting that, we are also, trying to engage or bringing some very novel ways of conducting research, like engaging the beneficiaries, the primary users of your product or solutions. One of them is lived experience expert. This group, for example, probably from the definition says when we say lived experience, is a unique form of knowledge, insight, expertise that comes from having experience of mental health challenge. This is very critical. So your application must demonstrate clear plan for collaborating with this expert in terms of engaging them on governance, planning, designing. We are not asking you to invite an experienced mentally health, someone who is suffering from mental health as part of the research participant. We're asking the team to clearly demonstrate how these people who have suffered from this condition and experienced through this can add values to your proposed project or proposal, okay? And then make sure that they will be compensated fairly. And also, you have to also bring some noble ways on how best approach can you really design integrate and engage lived experience expert in this project. The other section is about your capacity and experience. Dr. Esther has raised very important experience or important points when she explained about your about capacity and experience. It's important. It's one of the most important criteria that a reviewer is trying to look at. You may have noble ideas, probably, if the team capacity is or experience is not convincing for the reviewer, you know, probably you may not get selected. So we need you to explain your team members and their role. We gave you some enough space, like 500 words. So you give us your relevant experience, which enables you to win or to achieve the proposed objective. We also need you to give us some experience, especially if you are developing digital solutions, you know, your experience that enables you to develop that solutions. Okay, if you are applying as an like especially as a consortium, we need your track record of, you know, past achievement related to your proposed project. The other section is about potential for uptake and capacity building plan. In this section, we need two things. One is about your plan on how to use and manage evidence generated from your project that can be disseminated or used by mental health research community. And then you explain us how and what kind of activities are you proposing to promote, to engage, or to promote best use of evidence across different stakeholders, such as ministries, people with lived experience, other communities of practice. Please give us a detailed description how the member of the public, especially non-academic community, can be also be informed about key findings. You know, you have to have some imaginative thinking, just what I'm going to do to go to inform the wider public in addition to the academic communities. The other section is about, you know, capacity building plan. What is your plan in your proposal in terms of building leadership skills, especially if you have some early career researcher in your team, and in terms of creating some opportunity for learning when you engage with PLD, lived experience expert, how are you planning to engage with them, especially in creating learning opportunity, building the capacity, engaging with collaboratively across different disciplines, and also how you are planning to provide some mentorship to improve the capacity of less experienced individual. And then we have this ethics and the data protection. This is also critical for us, especially about ethics on ethical procedures, the way the data was collected is critical. You have to clearly identify and describe the potential risk for your project related to the ethical use of data, if there any harmful use of the research output, safeguarding risk for involvement approach for people with lived experience is very critical, and what strategies approach would you use to mitigate, you know, so when you use data, you know, you have learned about this data identification, de-identification, and also some ethical procedures during one of the course, I hope you remember. And you have to explain how the team approach and contribute to the sharing of the best practice of ethical, especially in use of sensitive data in the mental health community, research community. And then the other section is about data access and the governance and open science. We have four important keywords here. One is about access. You have to provide us the metadata for the data you are going to use. You have to provide us some evidence on authorization to access that data. If it is widely publicly or publicly available, you have to give us some end user's license. And then, or probably you may also add some additional data access agreement with the data owners. If you are using your own data, for example, if your organization is a data owner or controller, we need you to upload appropriate supporting evidence and agreement with the data controller. You know, sometimes you may apply, but you are not from the same institution, but you are not data owner. And you have to be, you have to communicate with them and reach out to the data, the primary data owner, and then bring some of the evidence. That is a critical thesis because we are encouraging existing use of data source. And then the other issues about data governance. You know, we appreciate if your organization has some data protection policy. If you explain about how your organization is protecting data or securing some of personal data as clearly as possible, especially outlining how your project really comply with the privacy law. There is international GDPR law. There is African Union data protection law. Probably in some of the country of focus may have also their own data protection law. You have to refer those countries and check how it is, the governance, data governance, data protection, data ethics was really clearly written in their policies. That's the most important, since we are also encouraging an open science framework in this project, we need you to discuss about how your work or project will comply with the open science principle. You have to clearly explain about how it aligns with the source principles, especially check those welcome or APHIC open access policy, mental health data guideline, and also some of the organization who talks about this open science framework. Okay, you have to tell us about how your output can also be available. You know, we need you, especially if you win this project, we need you, share the data publicly, code or a script, whatever you have, or if you develop any software, whatever, we need you to put it publicly. That's why we need how you are really strategizing or planning to guide it by the principles of open science framework. And then on the use of generative AI, we strongly suggest you to use these technologies for writing purpose only, especially to improve the language of your proposal. But when you use that, we need you to put the systems, like the portal systems, ask you to put this statement. We need, like during the preparation of this work, you have to specify the name of the AI tool you used in order to, you know, for what purpose did you use for that AI tool, and then how you reviewed or edited some of the content, and how, and take some full responsibility on the content you are really talking about. Why? Because some of the AI tools are really incorrect, unless really supervised, incomplete, and sometimes they are prone to bias. Now you have to be careful. And we have also a tool that can monitor this thing from your work. Declaration of conflict of interest. You have to declare, like there is a form again, like populates, that asks you about potential conflict of interest that may affect the review process or your work. Okay. And then you have to complete that declaration of statement when the system populates, when it goes through that submission. In terms of, there is a section which asks about timetable and milestone. You give us your Gantt chart with a proposed timeline and the milestone. While we also recognize you may need to adapt to your proposed plan in line with ongoing learning during the prize, but we need your plan for 12 months plan, a timeline, and some milestones for the proposed study or proposed project. In terms of using reference, make sure that you have cited appropriate reference and the right reference. in every argument or statement you put in your proposal. We have no strict formatting or referencing style format, but make sure that you use standardized or you use standard referencing format, okay? Consistently, if you are using, for example, Harvard style, it's better to be consistent and finish it in Harvard style. If you're using Vancouver, you have to please just be consistent on those referencing format. To improve that kind of, we encourage you to use some of the referencing management, such as in Drought, Mendeley, and Zotero. In terms of budget, at this stage, we need you to submit a summary of just, we need you this only this table. And then one thing, two things. One, the indirect cost shall not exceed 10% of your proposal, your budget. The maximum budget is 200K, 200K pound. And then the indirect cost shall not exceed 10% of this. If you are applying from institution outside Africa, remember, and this is 80% of the budget is going, should go to the African institution. And then you fill this table. Just simply, there is a box, dialog box, which populates just to fill those amount, total amount for personnel, for material, for equipment, for travel, and for indirect cost. How to submit? You will submit these applications through portal starting from Monday, July 1st, and ends on 31st July. Submission after 31st will be automatically, the system doesn't accept, will automatically reject it. Be careful. And please visit our website starting from Monday. This submits, start your application link will populate in on the main page. And then you will get a detailed description about the code. And when you are ready, you start filling your application. We do not accept application via email. In case you might get some challenge to submit through the portal, please send us an email through this contact address, and we will try to support you in the along with our IT technician. We also highly discourage you to late submission because of so many uncertainties within our continent. So please try to be vigilant and timely, submit your application time. After submission, when the primary, the lead applicant submits, the systems will immediately send a confirmation email that's saying that we have accepted this application. And then the second step is about the review process. Maybe we go through different stages, so it may take up to 2 months. We have evaluation criteria, and then we give you a decision for all, whether you are accepted or rejected. Rejection doesn't mean that you are not competent. Rejection means that, you know, there are some projects are qualifying better than, a little bit better than you. It's about a matter of score. And then we inform you about award notification, especially for those winners. The APHRC will communicate directly to the lead applicant. The review process passed through different stages. During the first stage, we check internally on the eligibility and the feasibility assessment criteria. Those proposals who score more than 65% of this criteria will be sent to external review. We have a list of panels for organized or for this review, and each proposal will be sent to 3 independent reviewers. And then through that deliberation or process, we select top 20 projects. Or imagine if we receive like 100 projects, maybe we select 20 projects. Then these 20 project, top 20 projects will be invited for oral presentation. After oral presentation, top 10 will be identified. Probably we may find from 5 to 10, we said. Top 10 best project will be invited, will be selected. And then based on the reviewer's recommendation and in the presence of advice, we have advisory board. At each stage, advisory board is responsible to check every process of review. And then we communicate the final decision to the winners based on the recommendation from the external reviewers and also a deliberation by advisory board. Now we are developing the feedback mechanisms while you are submitting, like starting from 1st July up to 31st, we will also develop this feedback mechanism too, where you can submit your concern, complaint, or feedbacks about the whole 5 months or the whole submission process, including review. And if you have some complaint or grievance, then we are also generating some redressing mechanism and the steps of addressing this complaint. So we value, this is the review process has these core values and the principle. We highly value the expert evaluation and the objectivity. When we select reviewers, it depends on the reviewer's qualification. We check representative units from African region. And also we check the diversity of profession and experience. We also checked the representation. No discrimination was made in terms of different parameters, age, gender, bias, religion, blah, blah. The scoring criteria are also very objective in each stage. And transparency is also one of our values, starting from developing the objectives, the criteria, the judgment for evaluation process, and the funding allocation. All will be transparent. All communication and the ongoing activity within this project was also public, and selection panels criteria are designed to be objective and managed in accordance with the guideline. We respect, we try to create an environment of respect based on trust, confidence, and excellence by fostering cooperation and consideration for diverse perspective. So it's our duty. And then we have fairness, impartiality. We try to become more impartial and objective. We are trying to avoid our conduct must be from competing, self-interest, prejudice, and favoritism. We really should be honest, and integrity is a key in this project. And we earnestly seek to understand the truth, and we encourage truthful, timely, and accurate communication for all participants without any discrimination. We will be more efficient and responsive. We value the timely communication is critical, and all communication, all review process will be confidential to keep the content of the proposal. You know, sometimes if you fail in this data prize, you can also submit other funding organizations. So nobody, or we guarantee that we do not communicate your proposal to third parties. The proposal shall not be shared and distributed to any third party without APHRC's primary or primary contact person of the project. So please refer our guideline and resource. If you have any more further information, if you need more further information, you can also check, send us an email through the project email or copy to me. I'm Ulusa, and Sylvia is our principal investigator, so that we can address accordingly. Thank you very much. If you have any question, let's entertain some of your question. Over to you. Are there any questions that we can discuss? Joy, it's over to you. Hello, Joy. Are you there?
Yes, sorry. I think I was speaking on the mute.
Okay.
So we have some questions from the chat. I mean, from the Q&A question section. And the first one is if you could give examples of conceptual mental health frameworks.
Sorry?
The first question is, could we have some examples of conceptual mental health frameworks?
Okay. This conceptual framework or theoretical framework may not be applicable to all projects, but when you have, for example, let's say you want to, for example, generate some insight about the, let me take as an example, insights about the impact of maternal depression on, like, let's say, child development, like child cognitive development. That's the question. So you have the data, so you want to generate some insight, because you, when you read some literature, you get some gaps. So you have to clearly tell us about what kind of theoretical or conceptual framework do you have in mind when you think maternal depression can influence child outcome, okay? And then you think, you go to the reviews of literature and develop or check some of the theories, you know, what kind of theories, some like generic or specific theories about maternal depression and the cognition, so that you can develop your own framework. Or conceptually, you know, you're saying that, you know, I'm going to look at I'm going to answer my research objective according to this conceptual framework or conceptual theoretical framework. Yeah. We don't have a specific conceptual mental health framework here, but it depends on the question that you have.
Okay, thank you very much. The other question, I think this is regarding the people with lived experience. The question is, can those people be part of the research team? I think this one has been covered.
Of course. It's a mandatory. If those referring, those people, if you are referring about people lived with experience, it is a mandatory, I said. Please check our guideline. They should be part of research team, and you should also explain how do you engage them. And starting from, I said, in one of my slides, and project design, governance, implementation, in each steps of your project implementation, how do you engage or involve lived experience expert? That is important.
Thank you very much, Murusu. I think we have another comment from Sylvia.
Sorry. Yes. Yeah, thanks very much, Murusu, and thanks, Joel. So on top of what Murusu just said, the expectation around lived experience, so it's it will be stipulated on the call, even during the application process, trying to explain what lived experience means, so if it's very clear. And what the recommendation is that this role is more of an independent role. So I would imagine if somebody is the principal investigator, the lead applicant, you would have somebody else. The preference is that this role is independent of the other roles within the project, but because as part of the implementation phase, the people with lived experience will receive support or expert support from a lived experience expert. So having double roles then makes it a bit complicated to work with. But I understand that individuals may find it difficult to access people with lived experience, but the preference is that you have this as a separate role within your team. I hope that clarifies in the sense. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sylvia. I think I think this addresses another the next question that was asked by Betty, which is I am a RIVD, I'm a person with RIVD experience and I am the RIVD applicant. Is that enough engagement or we need more? Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. So the other question is also on
let's answer this question.
Okay, sure.
Okay. Okay, the question is about we are not like when be mindful when you are a lead, make sure that when you are assigned yourself as a lead, well, we are not targeting whether you are a lived experience or not. You became a lead because you are capable, you have a good experience of leading the project, and you have a good idea to submit that project. That is important. And on top of that, if you have also such experience and become a lead applicant, it's okay. But we will have some mechanisms that we can monitor such experience. So it doesn't prevent you from, if you are really like, what I would say, we need, the lead applicant should be from professional background, from professional perspective, from like, you know, this lived experience is not something that you get from institutions. It is an experience or a knowledge that, or an insight that you gain from your life, from experience of having this condition. So what makes you the lead is not having that experience. What makes, what should make you the lead is having the qualified profession to lead that project.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for adding into that and for clarification. So the other question is, how can we then engage people with RIVD experience expert without gathering data from them? Please explain more on this, the possible kinds of engagement that we can take. So this person is asking about, since we are not doing data collection, how are we going then to involve people with RIVD experience? Okay, Sylvia? Oh, it's an old RIVD hand. Okay, Melissa.
Okay. No, we're not going to collect data and get those people. We're not like doing some survey and get the experience of those people. Yeah, we are looking for people who have experience. Yeah, within our environment, for sure, there are people who pass through these conditions and get recovered and to go back to their life. And it's obviously, we know, like when we create our team, that individual can be, can engage in the part of the research team. We are not saying, you know, go to the community and check the whether someone has an experience or not and is an include. No, we're saying, you know, from our daily life, we know from our team or from our community we live in, we know someone has passed through this mental health condition and gained some form of knowledge about the mental health condition, starting from the onset up to the treatment care, the care. Okay, there are some experience that people can talk. So these people should be, we are saying these people should be part of the team. We want to engage, why? Because we want to understand their perspective. They are the one who can speak to that condition. Yeah, so we are not like suggesting going through data collection.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think Estelle, you have something to add?
Yeah, thank you. I think for me, it's just a tip also for the group. If you see now all the calls on mental health, for all mental health proposal, one of the requirements is always to include your life experience because they have valuable insight, as we say. Also, one thing that we've discovered ourselves as an institution, when we're searching and looking on how we approach that, we've discovered that in a number of countries, there are actually groups, community groups that have people with lived experience or with mental health. So check in your countries. So just go to your, because you work in this field of mental health, we assume. So just ask to, you know, colleagues, other institutions, from your own colleagues in your institutions, ask around. Ask even, last time I asked the Ministry of Health in Kenya, and I was surprised to find a group at the community level. You can also ask the Ministry of Health, Division of Mental Health, are there particular groups that work with people with mental health, lived experience in mental health, or even health providers in the major psychiatric hospital in your country? They might lead you to a group. So once you identify the group, you can also have them as part of your proposal. And yeah, it makes your life easier. Thanks.
Thank you, Estelle, for adding to that. Fred, Dr. Fred, can add something?
I just wanted to clarify that people with lived experiences are not being engaged as external people. I mean, it's not like we're engaging them. They are part of the proposal team, the multidisciplinary team in their own right as experts. So, in fact, it's problematic already to say engaging them, those people. It's already a problem. We are looking at building a multidisciplinary team. And just like you'd look at experts from different areas, whether it's web developers, whether it's data scientists, whether it's policymakers, you're actually looking at individuals with lived experience, mental health lived experience, as experts in their own right. And that's why you'll see in our guidelines, we're actually calling them lived experience experts. So you're not going to them to collect data. We're not going to them to try and engage them because we want to get information from them. That's not how we're looking at this. Yeah.
Great. I think that was very well.
Yeah, I think it's really good that you raise all these points. It's very, very necessary for teams to recognize that they're not just engaging, like the way Fred said, and Estelle, you're not just engaging them to help the team. They actually contribute to the design, the conceptualization, the ownership, even the validation of those tools that you hope to develop or to share. So they are part of this whole process. So they should not be looked at as an add-on or something separate, and there'll be special support for the winning teams to work with a lived experience expert to actually integrate lived experience in the research that you will conduct. So the lived experience is not just about what you do with those people, it's actually how you integrate those insights in your development or your tools or your solutions. Yeah.
And Sylvia, let me just add again that we are not just doing this to tick a box. In describing the roles and responsibilities of the multidisciplinary team, we would really want to see what specific role and expertise the individuals with lived experience or lived experience experts are bringing on board. So shopping around for individual living experience, adding them on the list is not good enough. The idea is that, okay, listen, we are building this idea, data-driven solution for anxiety, depression, and psychosis. And this is our team of applicants, from the lead applicant to the other members of the application team. And these are the specific roles the application team is playing. So just adding an individual, you know, because they tick a box of lived experience expert without necessarily showing how they add value to that team will not cut it. So that really raises the game on the multidisciplinarity of the teams that the groups will be putting together. Over.
Thank you, Dr. Fred and Dr. Sylvia, for adding to that. I think we see a lot of question into people with lived experience. Yes, okay. Another question is how many team members, or the minimum number and or the maximum number of team members? I think you mentioned this, but maybe you can go by again, Dr. Muruso.
Okay, when we say multidisciplinary, it's obvious that we need diverse group. In terms of number, it depends on the question you have, who want to answer, or depends on the solutions you are going to develop. What kind of expertise, what type of diversity or skills and background do you need to develop that project? Is it one, two, more, three, four? Which discipline? You are the one who should really propose. Remember, having team diversity and the experience in your team is one of the important criteria that we are checking. So this be clever. You have to be clever, and it is you who decide. Depends on the question and the project depth or size. You can imagine when you write your proposal.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I think this is also, you can maybe talk about what kind of institutions that individuals can partner with in this proposal.
Well, it depends to the question you have. Could be public, it could be startup, like startup companies, and could be a non-governmental organization, or could be civil society. Okay, whatever you have, you want to consider as a partner. You know, you have some reason, you know. So, yeah, ranges from public, NGO, civil society, data scientist, or data science community, mental health, you know, associations, civil society, lived experience, expert, you know, so many. So, yeah, depends. Private
Thank
institutions
you
can also be part of this competition, okay?
Okay. We also have two questions regarding the fact that we are not collecting primary data. And one of it is that does it mean that negates the section that speaks about FGDs, interviews, or data collection or study tools?
I don't know if this person can speak to that idea, but we did not mention about this FGD or interview, whatever. I don't know if one of the slides that talks about design and the method is about, like, you know, when you use the secondary data or existing data source. I hope this data source have collected using some tools, whether it is quantitative or whatever, qualitative. Okay. So we are asking you, please tell us how that data was collected. How, what kind of data collection procedure they followed, measurement tools they used, blah, blah, okay, kind of that information. We did not mention about the FGD interview, but I appreciate if you can, or if she can speak to that idea.
Yeah. I think I understand where this person is coming from, and this is Samuel, I think, from Nigeria. I think this is about the conventional research proposals that are structured in a ways where, you know, you have study designs, and then you have all this about tools. But I think what we are saying is that we have to think beyond research being primary data collection. We have to start looking at existing data and how we can move that data beyond just analyzing it, describing it, and, you know, presenting things like prevalence of mental health conditions and things like that. So what we're trying to say, and that is really the movement globally and among funders, is that a lot of data has been collected a lot of data exists that can actually be utilized further to provide solutions. And this prize funded by the Wellcome, as you would know, is actually driving that effort to say there's a lot of information out there and we don't want to keep collecting primary data and keep lumping to what's already existing. So the idea is that look at data from a totally different standpoint. Don't look at it as a source for describing tables and prevalence and things like that. Look at how do you bring people with lived experiences or lived experience experts to your team and say, this is the data, this is what information we've had over the years. Then do we interpret this and provide solutions for anxiety, depression, and psychosis, right? So this is just limited by your imagination, and we will not, I don't think it's within our scope to provide guidance on how you can look at secondary data and how you can bring in other expertise, policymakers, how you can bring in other individuals listed as part of the multidisciplinary team to look at that data outside the box. So that's the challenge we are giving. And as we know, with any competition, with any prize, it's the creative ideas that get funded. So we are leaving this challenge to all of you and say, look at the data that you have. If you cannot, you don't have the data, look around for who has data. Partner with them. Say, listen, this is the expertise I'm bringing on board. You have the data. Can we work together to form this multidisciplinary team and apply for this prize? This is a challenge for country teams, inter-country teams, collaborators across their countries who come from different disciplines, who are willing to form a multidisciplinary team without forgetting policymakers, without forgetting lived experience experts, and proposing an out-of-box idea on how they can use secondary data to provide or to develop data-driven solutions for the three important conditions, anxiety, depression, and psychosis. I don't think we can overemphasize that, and that will remain the challenges that teams have to beat for them to get funded. Over.
Thank you very much. I think that was very well explained. Is there anyone who wants to add a comment, Wilson?
Not from my side. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So the next question is, again, also on data collection, I think, which has also been addressed. So since there is no consideration of data collection, if they cannot get access to secondary data, I think this person is talking about access to data or what to do if individuals do not have access to data.
Here is a short answer. Yeah, here is how I think I have to repeat this. The question is about what if we don't get that secondary data? That is a question.
Yes.
So, okay, our response is we do not allow, you know, the primary data collection is out of the scope. We cannot allow for primary data collection, but we highly encourage you to look for the secondary data, starting from your own institution, your own country, up to the other African institution, and then reach out to the data owner. And then throughout that, access, throughout reaching that data, those data owners, probably we may like copy us, we may like request, facilitate with you about your data request. Otherwise, primary data collection is out of the scope of this prize.
Great. Thank you very much. But maybe you can also mention about the recipient, the data that we are collecting in the site repository. Dr. Sylvia?
Yeah, I was going to request Moloso to talk about the metadata repository. So it's just directing participants to where potential data sources might be and providing the metadata, that is the data that describes that data that may be available then or may be specified in some protocols. So Moloso can speak to that.
In terms of the data, we try to develop mental health data repository. The first step that now we're doing is listing those available studies across Africa. You can look at on our website and type some keywords, whatever study design or whatever study you want to look for, and then you can get some ideas about the project that has been conducted across Africa. That is the most important and useful information. The second step is beyond this. We are trying to just generate some exemplary data. We are not going for all countries, but we are trying to generate exemplary data sources, especially those who are widely or publicly available from some countries like Ethiopia, South Africa, Kenya, including Kenya. So we will finalize this and share it to our add to those that website.
Thank you very much, Dr. Musu. Another question is regarding the qualification of the applicants. So could you also talk about if the lead applicant must have a PhD or can be a junior researcher?
So I've tried to address that directly on chat, but as much as there is no minimum academic qualification, but we know in research, matching academic qualifications and skills and experience and conceptual understanding of research is a key lever, right? It's an important thing. So demonstrating that, of course, is key. But if someone has extensive experience and can properly articulate issues. And really, this is not even about the individual. As you've seen, we are emphasizing really about the multidisciplinary team. And as much as we understand academia and research may require perhaps PhD level training, those other members of the multidisciplinary team may not require such kind of academic qualification. So it's important for us to look beyond the individual. As much as the lead applicant, as Mulus mentioned, should be properly grounded in research and research design to be a proper leader for this team. The other members really also count and may not require such academic qualification. And perhaps while I'm at it, I could also talk to the question by Mawanda, who is asking whether we can elaborate more about data-driven digital solutions. I would want to remove the word digital solutions from this discussion, because it's not just about digital solutions. Digital solutions would be one of those, but there could be many other solutions which are data driven beyond digital solutions. So Molus, I think we would want to clarify that digital solution is not the only solutions we're looking at. We are looking at several solutions for as long as they are data driven. When we say data driven, we say you need to use evidence coming from data. It's evidence informed. It is not just out of the blues. So yes, it could be based on what is the situation informed by data, and therefore what solution are you developing? That's what data-driven solution is all about. So it's not just about digital. It could be community approaches. It could be anything. Like I said, it's only limited by imagination. And when a team comes together from different disciplines, when you have a policymaker, when you have a person with lived experience, you have academia, you have researchers, I don't know, you have community mobilizers, you name it. I'm sure if you sat down together and looked at the data and evidence that you have, it's possible to come up with an out-of-the-box solution for anxiety, depression, and psychosis. And that's, again, I will emphasize that that's a challenge we're throwing to individuals on this call. 80 of you on this call should be figuring out how you can harness or leverage the multidisciplinarity and information from different disciplines to come up with a data-driven solution for anxiety, depression, psychosis. And I don't think we're talking about all the three conditions in one project. It could be a condition, just one condition. It could just be psychosis, could just be depression, could just be anxiety, or it could be all three or just two, you know. So it really depends on the data you have and the study population that you're focusing on. It could be, you know, postpartum women, it could be, I don't know, young people, it could be relevant. I think Muluso has really touched on that. So it's really possible that the team coming together can develop a solution that is informed by the evidence from the data that you may be holding or you can access. And then injecting other, you know, other approaches from the different disciplines to make value out of it. Over to you, Joel.
Yeah, thank you very much for addressing that. Another question we have is on the participation, the number of papers someone can participate in. So the question is, can one appear in different groups of application? And also, can one institution submit more than one application? Morrison, maybe you can address this.
One person can appear in multiple projects, but cannot be the lead applicant. Different group from one institution can also apply for this call. So one institution can also submit more than one application, but the lead, maybe Fred can comment on that. How there will, if an institution can be a lead, I don't think they can also be the lead for the other project. They can be a lead on one of those multiple projects. Yes.
Indeed, yeah. I mean, this is standard standard guideline for most proposals. I mean, you can be a lead only in one, but you can also be a sub in many other applications. You know, it's, I think if you want to use a colloquial language, it's spreading your bread upon many waters, right? It's expanding your chance and opportunity to be selected either as prime or a sub in another one. So if you're doing that genuinely in the sense that you're happy to lead one proposal and also participate in other groupings, it's okay, but you cannot be a lead for two proposals as one institution. Neither can you be a lead for two proposals as the same individual.
Hey, thank you very much for clarifying that. And also we have a question on, what will be the contribution of such a person considering that the data is already available? Does it mean their experiences should guide the proposal? What will be their role? Maybe Marifa, you can unmute and ask the question since I didn't quite understand it.
Joel, I think I understand. I think we're still talking about lived experience individuals. And so this is, again, an area where we're saying that we really need to change the way we look at lived experience experts. They are not just sources of data. So the moment we transcend that thinking, I think it will be easy for us to answer this question. So you're bringing in individuals with lived experience as experts so that together you can think of a solution. So you're not starting at the point where you're inviting them because you want to tick a box. No. You're starting from zero and you're saying, okay, can we have this team put together? Of course, there has to be some data involved. So perhaps one person has data, the other person is coming in as a lived experience expert, the other person as a policymaker. We know policymakers may have or may not have data to contribute to this, and then working together to develop a solution. So that's, I think that's the most we can say, and we cannot overemphasize this. So it's not just them, such a person. No, I already have a problem with that language. Those people, such a person, no. Consider these are team, and among the team, the different classifications being academia, researchers, policymakers, lived experience experts, you know, etc., etc. And then together you develop that solution, and then you put together a winning proposal. So I think really that's the most we can say about that.
Okay, thank you very
may,
much.
May I add this on this?
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, I want to give them some framework or very some jargons in this grant writing. Like, remember the issue, the concept of co-creation. Co-designing, co-creation, human-centered design. What this whole framework is talking about, like engaging all stakeholders and driving or getting some solution to the problems where we defined. Okay, so look at from the concept of co-creation, not for the concept of like, it's not you are supporting them, you are considering them as an expert, adding value to your question. Even they can define, when you define your research question, someone may explain, like, for example, okay, you want to argue, you want to analyze, for example, the age of onset of mental health condition is, you know, the popular evidence is, okay, young age. Okay, if I have an experience on this condition, like prior to my younghood, if I can argue that, you know, no, it could be childhood. And that gives you some guidance about reformulating your question. And also I can like support on design or analysis of those data, and also managing the data. The way we are expecting expertise from the other group. You can also get expertise knowledge from lived experience expert. Over to you, Joy.
Okay, thank you very much. And then maybe you can also address a question that came in the previous session, which was if people applying have to be part of the previous Mental Health Data Prize Africa Capacity Building Program.
Okay. Yeah, that is also a critical question. This call is open for everyone. The engagement on that capacity building program is part of, you know, the process. It is, you know, we are trying to share the skills and knowledge that we have by bringing those expertise on board. It's not part of the prerequisite or requirement to be part of the team. So when you form your team, you can also reach out to other expertise outside this cohort, outside this mental, those who registered for this capacity building program, and then formulate or form your team. It's for everyone. As far as that individual adds value to your team, please collaborate.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, another question is, must the collaboration be inter-country, or one can collaborate within a given country? I think this was addressed.
Yeah, I think Fred has answered that.
Yeah. Okay, I don't see any other question unless we check in the chat. So in the chat, I didn't
some
see any
two
other
hands. Joel, yes. There's some two hands. Okay. I think maybe you may want to. They may want
okay,
to
sure.
Speak. Yeah.
Sure. So we have, let's start with John Jero. John Jero, can go ahead.
Do you need to unmute them? Unmute?
Yeah, they have the permission now. They can just unmute. Okay, then let's have Reta. Lata Fekadu. Are you there? Okay. He dropped the hand, the raised hand. Okay. So we don't have another question. So maybe someone can ask a question, or you can use the Q&A also. It's still open. Yeah, there is a new question that how many studies do you purpose to fund?
I think this might be someone who's just joining us now. Yeah, we mentioned that there are up to 10 prizes up for grabs, to use that colloquial term. And yeah, I mean, maximum 10, but they have to be, you know, good ideas. We could fund just 5 perhaps, if those are the good ideas. But is assuming you get 20, we can only fund up to a maximum of 10. Good idea, sir. I hope that is helpful to the anonymous attendee. And I think there's a question from Sonia, Joel. Sonia is asking, if a team does not have a lived experience member, is that fine and are they still eligible? I think my colleague Sylvia had actually mentioned that as much as this is desirable, we appreciate that it could be difficult for some teams to have you know, lived experience experts within their composition. Now, if it's a competitive call, you can imagine that teams that have lived experience experts among them will score higher than such a team that does not have a lived experience member within it. So that's already a fact. But in the event that you have among the great ideas a team that does not have a lived experience, we have constituted within ourselves an advisory group involving individuals with lived experience who can provide guidance and expertise to such teams on how they can engage individuals with lived experience when developing the solutions that they are actually developing. So I hope that is helpful to you, Sonia.
Yeah, great. Any other question that maybe?
Someone is asking about the question about why can't you do pre-qualification using abstract kind of question that allow the selected individual submit to this full proposal. Okay. I think for this question, the first stage, during the first stage of evaluation, we have an eligibility and the feasibility assessment criteria. We are not only looking abstract, we have detailed criteria, and then we allow those individuals who would score greater than 65 to the second stage. Yeah, I hope this clarifies.
I don't see any other raised hand apart from the old raised hand. Thank you for commenting.
So, Joel, I have one comment.
Yes.
Did you address the question about does a backup plan refer to writing the proposal to another funding organization?
Not yet.
Okay, so
maybe Murusi, you can take that.
Let me understand the question.
So the question is in the webinar chat, not the Q&A.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You mean as a PhD student who want to apply for bank funding, or which one is it?
No, no. There is a question on by Adair.
Yeah, can you read
a backup plan? Does a backup plan refer to writing the proposal to another funding organization?
Yeah, okay. Okay, let
so
me get the question
probably
straight.
Maybe from Estelle's presentation where she talked about a backup plan.
Maybe.
Okay.
But
okay.
I can also
maybe
ask
it could be.
And
I got you.
And we...
The backup plan is like, I think she's trying to explain, like, imagine if you do not make to this call, like, don't get discouraged to apply for other funding organizations. But we do not allow you to submit multiple applications, like one proposal which you submitted to another organization, like, if there's a declaration on conflict of interest. But in case if you do not make to this call, probably you can also submit another time to the other clinic organization. That is what I want to say.
Yeah, perhaps the person who asked the question, Andrea, can let us know, because on the other hand, it could be that they're talking about risk mitigation within this application. So what if they don't get the data, or what if, that could also require a backup plan. So what risks you have within your application and how you mitigate those risks. Yeah, over.
Yeah, it's also good
Okay.
to hear from her, maybe if she can speak too.
Yes, let me unmute her. Adele, you can unmute. Andrea? Go on. Yes, go ahead.
Hello.
Hello, go ahead.
Yes, my question was just to get to know the meaning of this backup plan. It's like when you are somewhere, you are told that one of the things you need to do, apart from making your application to be clear, is also to have a backup plan. So, what would that mean as far as application is concerned? Does it mean that now you should be thinking in terms of if I fail to succeed in this application, then there is another option or plan B which I could pursue. That's what I meant. Thank you.
I think this is from, I don't know if the doctor still is here, but I think that statement or that phrase is from Dr. Stell's presentation. I would also say she was alluding to that, like, if you do not succeed to this project, you must have a backup plan, okay, to apply for other funding organizations. For this project, at the moment, we have only this data prize. If you make it to this project, if you are part of the 10 project, we continue for the next 12 months with us. Otherwise, if you fail, you can submit to the other funding organization your project ideas.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I don't see any other question. Anyone who has another question?
Maybe
Can
just to
use the chat also.
clarify on
Yes,
the
please.
person who asked how many proposals will be funded. So it's up to 10 proposals. Up to 10 proposals will be funded through this call. So if we find 10 very good solutions, it will be 10. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Do we have any other questions? And also, yeah. Dan, maybe you can clarify your question. You say for the purpose of benefiting the population. Maybe you can ask your question, Dan. Let me unmute you. Go ahead, Dan. Dan Kagwa.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Okay, I was asking for purposes of benefiting the population. If you find a very good idea that you think if well developed would be actually very beneficial, but the team has not kind of put it to your satisfaction, would you come in early and guide that team before you even start selecting the best proposal or something like that?
Morrison, you want to answer that?
The question is interesting, but what we have in our mind is the application will open on Monday, starting 1st July, and everybody will apply up to 31st, and then we start reviewing the proposal at each stage. So I think there is no room to go into the system and check and the proposal and see whether it is beneficial or not. What we have now is we want to compile all application, and we have clear criteria of evaluation, and we take those criteria at each stage. And then if you make it, you will win. If don't, that is the way the review process and prize was is we are planning to manage this prize. Maybe Sylvia or Fred can also add on that.
No, you're right. Also, it's difficult to intervene during the application process, and as you said, there are questions that will be interpreted. Consulting on an idea will be considered conversing, but if there are application questions regarding the application process itself, those can be sent to the email that you provided. But I don't think you can pilot an idea through the team to see whether it can fit and then go back and develop. I don't think there's an allowance for that.
Yeah, and perhaps I think if the idea is really good and it's picked up by the reviewers, then at some point the last 20 will have the opportunity to speak about it. So that that's at really a higher level, but not at the application stage. Yeah, and I hope it's clear, because it could be that you have a very good solution, but maybe a few things were not clear, and those you can bring up or can be brought up during the second stage. But that's really looking at the final stage, close to the final stage, the discussion stage. But if you have a very good idea, it's really important that you put forward what you want to do and how you want to do it in a very explicit way that the reviewers will pick it up at the first stage. So that's what I can say for now. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Amusu and Fred and Sylvia for those comments. We still have some time for questions, so feel free to ask questions. I don't see any other question at the moment. Raised hands. Okay, if not, then I will ask Mursu if you want to have maybe some final comments, and also go to Fred to also have final comments, and then Sylvia to close off the meeting. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Joel. Thanks everyone who joined this meeting. Please go through those guidelines and instruction form that we uploaded in our website and also shared. I don't know if you joined the WhatsApp group. We also make these slides and also this webinar, recordings of this webinar on YouTube. I wish you good luck. Please try to stay focused, do your work, and win this prize. We wish you everyone a success. Thank you.
Thank you, Mursu. Fred, any comment?
No, just looking forward to receiving the applications from the team. Again, let's reiterate that we are looking for out of the box ideas, data-driven solutions for anxiety, depression, and psychosis. The idea does not have to incorporate all the three conditions. It can be one. The idea has to be a contribution of a multidisciplinary team. The idea can be within a country or across countries, but more importantly, the idea has to be, novel. It has to be out of the box, and it has to demonstrate that there's an out of the box thinking on developing solutions for these conditions. I want to encourage people on the call to look around some of the projects that had been developed in the previous data prizes funded for the UK and South Africa. This information is freely available on the net. Wellcome have published this because that's the whole idea, and get inspiration from such. The center of everything, there has to be data, because you're looking for data-driven solutions for anxiety, depression, and psychosis. And all the best.
Thank you very much, Fred, for your comments. And we can officially close from Sylvia. You can give us some of your final comments.
Yeah, thanks, Joel. And thanks very much, Mulusu. And thanks to Estelle, who went through the grant writing process. And I hope the sessions have been really useful to address the questions from your end that were pending, that will help you put up very good proposals. And I just want to say that when we think about data-driven solutions, not to forget that there's the human face to mental health that we need to address, because mental health is still health. It's about health of individuals. So we need to not forget the human side of the solution. So and we should keep in mind that we use data to solve solutions that are driven by the needs within the communities that we come from. So the solution should address a need and not use the solution as some kind of adaptation to solve what we think is the problem. So looking at it from that perspective, we are really looking forward, because you know the context in which you work, you know the challenges, you have people on board who have experienced or who have lived with mental health disorders. And understand the challenges and what it means, the stigma that is involved. And we want to address some of those issues, or most of those issues, to drive the mental health landscape within Africa. So as long as you have the expertise on your team, you have the right collaboration, you have the right tools, you have the understanding of the challenges with your multidisciplinary team, then we should see some very good potential solutions in this context to make changes, especially that there is not enough data from the African context. So I'm really calling upon you to work within your multidisciplinary teams to look at it from the needs-driven side, given that you know you live in the context in which all these disorders happen. And particularly paying attention to the scope, the remit of this call, and the requirements, the eligibility, and making sure that whether it's from the qualitative context, that you have data-driven insights that actually drive solutions in this area to solve mental health. That's a really, really good. So out-of-the-box solutions really come from grassroots, from knowing our context and what works. So a lot of mHealth, eHealth tools are out there, but very few are scaled because of the problems that exist within our setting. So be mindful of all the existing, and then look at what innovations or new methods or new adaptations or new populations that reach, and tools that reach the marginalized to solve these problems. So thank you so much for being patient till the end of the call. I thank our facilitators. I thank the team from the Mental Health Data Prize. They've done a tremendous job in getting us to this point, and opportunity for you to get to know what is required. You have the emails, the YouTube channel will post the webinar today on the platform, on all our social media websites. They should be available for you, and we'll compile the Q&A and also provide some feedback on that. So wishing you the best in your applications, and see you soon for the next webinar. Thank you. Back to you, Joel.
Thank you very much, and see you everyone in our next session tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Bye, thank you.
Bye, thank you.